This is University Lecture.
Welcome to another in a series of lectures given on the campus of Iowa State University in Ames. Today we present the last of the lectures from the 1969 World Affairs Institute on the USSR, the second half century. Today's speaker is H. Kent Geiger, professor of sociology at the University of Wisconsin, speaking on the distribution of values and interests in the Soviet class system. Professor Geiger.
I think that you will agree that in a closed totalitarian society, the problem of the distinction between actual and ideal behavior is of the greatest importance. I had the honor to participate in the first substantial breakthrough of information about how the Soviet people actually live and feel. I was a member of the Harvard Project on the Soviet Social System. And in the course of a year's time, social scientists interviewed a large sample of refugees from Soviet Russia. And we found some very interesting things that I think I can safely say were not known before we found them out. We found, for example, an impressively strong contrast between the idealized and the actual behavior of the Soviet political leadership. That doesn't surprise you, perhaps, but we also found substantial integration or correlation between ideal and expected patterns in some very important respects. We found that Soviet refugees were very proud of their Soviet educational system. We found that they were reasonably satisfied and proud of their system of free medical care and other aspects of the Soviet social welfare system. And we found that, by and large, this group of refugees from Soviet society were proud to call themselves socialists. They were not interested in capitalism or tsarism, but even though they were living in poverty and insecurity in Western Germany, they were socialists. Well, this is an interest that I have and that many of my colleagues have. There is no standard terminology. There is no standard conceptual scheme. But one thing is true, that both in the Soviet Union, among social scientists and philosophers and politicians, and in this country, we use both the concept of interest in the sense of interest group or vested interests, which has a long and important history in Marxist thought, and the concept value. I think both of them are valuable, both of them are useful to us, and I'm going to try and put them to work today to make an initial exploration into the daily life of the Soviet people. So that's the second source of inspiration for what I'd like to talk about. A third source is the fact that we live in a society of nations. When I say society, I don't refer to American society, but world society. That you will all agree that in this century, we are all neighbors, and we all have to know something about each other to live in reasonable peace and satisfaction. This has presented a problem to social scientists who like to think that we are helping us all along in these tasks. The problem I'm referring to is that of characterizing a society with reasonable brevity and efficiency. What is Russia? Well, from the time that I started to specialize in Soviet affairs, people asked me that. They didn't always ask it in exactly that way. They might say, "What do you think of Russia?" But I knew that when they were asking me what I thought of Russia, what they really wanted me to do was to say something important, powerful and brief. And I wasn't able to do it very often. I think we might be able to do it if we use the idea of the concept of values. I made an initial effort to do this in 1964 at the annual meeting of the American Association for the Advancement of Slavic Studies. I called the paper, which I read, Values and Social Integration in the USSR. In this paper, on the basis of scattered bits of evidence, and I would say a good deal of armchair-like speculation, I argued that among the values shared by the Soviet people as a whole could be included, for instance, education, that the Soviet people had developed an admiration and desire for formal schooling, for technical learning, for attending advanced institutes and universities and so on, which could be summarized by saying that the word obrazovanie, education, had become a sacred word. Well, it has become gratifying to learn that in the years since 1964, there has appeared a good deal of Soviet sociological research of respectable quality, which has focused precisely on that subject and has established the fact that that education is indeed a major value among the Soviet people. So that this is now something that we can say with more assurance than we could, for example, 5 years ago. Let me refer to one study that was published in the journal Voprosi Filosofii, Problems of Philosophy, in 1965 by a Soviet sociologist named Shubkin. In the Novosibirsk region of the USSR, he and his colleagues studied approximately 9,000 graduates of the Soviet secondary school with a view to finding out their wishes in regard to their future. In particular, did they wish to continue full-time study in a Soviet educational institution? The results were very impressive. Of this sample of secondary school graduates in the Novosibirsk region, 83% of the entire sample did indeed wish to continue study. And if that sample was broken down in the traditional sociological fashion into what we might call upper level, middle level, and lower level youth from families of those different social levels, we found the interesting fact that although there was a slight tendency for the students who came from families in which the father was an urban, non-manual worker to have stronger desire to continue education, that the truly interesting fact was that every subgroup in the whole sample did manifest this desire to continue with their education. So it does appear to be a value shared by all social levels in the Soviet Union, as best we know. And even the sons of peasants living on the collective farms and state farms did share this wish. 76% in this particular study wished to continue their schooling beyond the secondary school graduation year. It's not important to my point at this moment to call your attention to the fact, but it is interesting. So I will point out that this study and others like it that have come to approximately the same conclusion, I think merit almost already the reputation of classic. The reason they merit that reputation is that the Soviet scholars went on in the years afterward to follow this cohort of young people in their further careers. From 76% to 93% of them wished to continue studying. What percent actually did continue to study? Well, the result was electrifying to the sociologists, and I'm sure to many people in the Soviet Union. The students who came from the relatively advantaged family background in which the fathers were urban, non-manual workers, were able, to the tune of 82%, to continue study past the secondary level, whereas the boys and girls who came from peasant backgrounds were able to continue only to the tune of 10%. So what we have here is a very interesting and important fact in which use was made of what I referred to earlier as the ideal pattern of behavior and the actual pattern of behavior. And when the two are contrasted in the way in which I have just done, I think you will agree that this is a productive and interesting operation. Thinking about values now has led me to become more and more aware of the fact that there is what I call a problem of salience. That is to say, when you inspect empirical data about what people want, what they're really interested in, you find that people tend to respond largely in symbols whose reference in real life are somehow problematic. What do I mean by problematic? What I mean is conditions that are difficult to bring about, or endangered, or not in perfect alignment, and, I believe, capable of some modification which presents itself to individuals as an opportunity. In the 1964 depiction of Soviet values, I argued that peace, material well-being, and social equality are other nationally shared positive values among the Soviet people, and that they share this with the value placed on education. These are all, if my argument is correct, salient in people's minds. And one of the reasons that they are salient, I think, is that they are inherently difficult or problematic, difficult to realize. On the other hand, if one takes this approach and tries to study normative culture, one quickly learns that there are features in the life of the Soviet people or any people which do not ordinarily appear in their thought, in discourse. They are not salient. Perhaps they are not problematic. And I am proposing to denote these as interests. To summarize this point, I think we badly need a way to describe society, and I think that if this approach can be developed, it will be very helpful, that we will be able to talk about all our neighbors in the world efficiently and meaningfully. I might mention, for the benefit of any sociologists in the audience, that there is a continuing controversy in my field about the best model to use in interpreting the process of social change. One model might be called the interest model or the conflict of interest model, and it has its roots largely in the Marxist view of society. The other model is sometimes called the equilibrium or value model of society. And we have felt in the past that these two approaches are somewhat mutually exclusive or contradictory. In this approach which I'm taking today, I'm proposing that they can be merged creatively. A fourth source of inspiration I will mention more briefly, and that has been the rise in the world for the first time of a genuine parallel desire on the part of scholars, with the approval of their politicians, in many different countries to perform standardized comparative research. In 1964, 5, and 6, an organization supported by UNESCO with the imposing title the European Coordination Center for Research and Documentation in Social Sciences of the International Social Science Council, or referred to briefly as the Vienna Center, undertook to organize a pilot project in international cooperative social research. It was described in a publication which appeared in the American Behavioral Scientist in December 1966. The chief author is Alexander Salai, spelled S-Z-A-L-A-I, formerly professor of sociology at the University of Budapest and at the, you'll have to excuse the pronunciation, Veszprém University for Chemical Industries in Hungary, and a member of the Hungarian Academy of Sciences. This organization sponsored the Multinational Comparative Time Budget Research Project, in which research institutes in 10 different countries participated in gathering information about a seemingly innocuous, but in my opinion, very revealing kind of behavior, how people spend their time. The countries that were represented were Belgium, Bulgaria, France, Hungary, Poland, West Germany or German Federal Republic, Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia, United States of America, and last but not least, the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. The organization which represented the United States was the well-known and very competent Survey Research Center of the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. The organization which represented the USSR was the Institute for Economy and Organization of Industrial Production of the USSR Academy of Sciences in Novosibirsk. This project was carried out in the countries participating in the same way, using standardized questions for interviews, using systematic sampling techniques, and using, as far as possible, the same kind of survey site. The goal was to select in each country a city somewhere between 75,000 and 200,000 that would have a minimum number of people engaged in it in agricultural occupations. So it was then an investigation into the free time or into the time expenditures of urban adults. This, I believe, is a truly breathtaking development, and this also has inspired me to attack the problem in the way that I have. I'd like to go now to the pattern of time usage in the Soviet Union. The usage of time has been researched in the USSR with some thoroughness in the 1920s. The Soviet leadership was interested in a number of things, which we might summarize most succinctly by saying the most efficient, rational use of labor. And the Soviet leaders were very impressed, for example, with the fact that the scholars who studied the use of time by the Soviet people proposed that housewives preparing individual meals in individual kitchens every day for their families could be released to take a place in the labor force if people could be persuaded to eat in gigantic kitchens or communal restaurants. And careful calculations were made in the 1920s showing how much labor time could be saved if they could do away with the individual kitchen of the family. As I mentioned, sociology died prematurely in the 1930s and 40s, but came back to life in the 1960s, and I think some of the very best research in Soviet Russia has been done on the way in which time is spent. They're interested in the length of the workday, how long it takes to get to work and back, how much time people have to spend standing in line. They're interested in knowing people's patterns of behavior in regard to planning for the construction of new housing facilities. recreational facilities and so on. Now, if we can use this information from Soviet Russia, and if we can also study the subject comparatively, I think we can learn some very interesting things. Just this morning, for example, in a conversation with Professor Thien at the breakfast table, he indicated to the group that in his observation in traveling in the Soviet Union, the Soviet people spent a lot of time in parks and on the streets. Well, I know that he will be gratified to learn that in table number 5-2, not in the material you'll have in front of you, but in another publication which I have in my possession, of the American Behavioral Scientist appendix to the report, this is exactly the situation which is reported. These researchers tried to ascertain the locale of each minute of time spent by people in all these different countries during the day, and sure enough, the Soviet people in 11 out of 18 possible comparisons ranked highest among all these countries in the amount of time spent per day on the street and in the parks. And in the other 7 of the 18 comparisons, they ranked second highest. The Yugoslavs spend a lot of time in the streets and parks too. We can also use this information to study subgroup patterns with considerable efficiency. The main result, perhaps, of the time budget studies in Soviet Russia and in the comparative approach has been to publicize the last major exploited category, the women. In all the studies done, it has been shown that women have less freedom than men. What do I mean by freedom? I refer to free time. And I'm using amount of free time per day as a crude but effective measure of freedom. For example, in the Soviet Union, in the age group 25 to 29, in a national study which recently appeared, men have on the average almost 5 hours of free time a day, whereas women have only a little more than 3 hours of free time. In the age group 30 to 39, the men have 4.6 hours and the women have only 2.5 hours. Now this is true in Russia, and it has, I think, exercised the Soviet leaders and ideologists very much, because they realize that this is unfair and that this is a form of de facto exploitation. And I think the Soviet leaders still feel strongly about exploitation. Under one circumstance, we can use the information about time budgets to study interests and values. And that is the circumstance that data are collected in which people relate not only how they spend their time, but how they would like to spend their time. And there has been a study done, published in 1967, based on a national sample of Soviet urban adults, in which these people were asked to indicate how they spend their days in some detail, and also how they would like to spend, not the whole day, because it is assumed that everyone must work in the Soviet Union and sleep and so on, but how they would like to spend the free time available to them. This poll of a national sample was conducted by an organization called the Public Opinion Institute of Komsomolskaya Pravda. Komsomolskaya Pravda is the Soviet youth newspaper. You know that Pravda is the official organ of the Soviet Communist Party. Komsomolskaya Pravda is the official organ of the Komsomol, or the All-Union Leninist Youth League. It's a reputable organization, however, and it has been very interesting for me to follow closely the results of their activities and to see the substantial improvement that has taken place. The sample on which the statistics in the tables in front of you is based is a close approach to a random sample. They're poor over there. They don't have much experience. They don't have experienced interviewers stationed in all corners of the USSR, as we do in this country. So to our highly sophisticated pollsters in the Gallup organization and the Roper organization and so on, it probably doesn't seem too impressive. But to me and to others who have followed Soviet social science, it's very impressive. They used what they call a cross sample. They chose a parallel and a longitudinal line, and they took all the cities that came within a certain number of kilometers of these two geographic features, and then they randomly interviewed people in households within the cities that were chosen. What is the structure of the expenditure of time in the Soviet Union? Well, that is what Table 1 is concerned with in this paper. It's an analysis of how the Soviet people spend their leisure time hours. Putting on the hat and puffing on the pipe of Sherlock Holmes, I decided that the average Soviet person has 4 hours and 24 minutes of spare time each day. That's not quite the truth. I did perform a little bit more rational calculation to come to that conclusion, which is described in the notes to the table, which I won't take the time to go into now. Let's look at how these hours and minutes are spent. By far the largest block is given over to the mass media of communication. Almost 2 hours per day are spent with the newspapers, magazines, and books. This comes to approximately 44% of the time available, and this shows us the degree to which the Soviet people, like modernized peoples everywhere, participate in a national culture each day. There are some interesting internal differences, though. In the Soviet Union, people read more and listen to the radio more and watch television less than in the United States. And indeed, they watch television less than is the case in many other countries. From the cross-national study of how people spend their time, it was revealed that Americans spend about three times as much time per day watching television as do Soviet Russians. The next major category, and they're listed in order, is what we might call socializing or social activities. The largest group here, and now I'm looking at the first column in Table 1, the largest group here, item here, is time devoted to children. This does not refer now to child rearing in a narrow sense, which is a separate category in the study, but to games and essentially recreational or free time activity spent with children. Now, I mentioned to you earlier that Professor Thien had wisely observed an interesting fact about Soviet Russia when he was there, how much time they spend on the streets. It seemed to me, on the basis of what I had learned about the Soviet family, that the amount of time spent with children might be different in the USSR than in other countries. And so I eagerly turned to the cross-national study to look at the information which appeared there to see if the Soviet people do spend more time with their children or less time with their children than people in other countries. As it turns out, they spend just about the same amount of time with their children. But here again, if one looks carefully at the information available, you find such interesting facts as if you look only at employed Soviet mothers in the labor force, you'll find that they spend more time with their children than do American mothers who have children. But if you look at non-employed mothers, you'll find that in the Soviet Union, non-employed mothers spend less time with their children than do the non-employed American mothers. Now, I cite this as an interesting fact, which you can probably use sometime during the weekend in your dinner table conversation. Second category is social activities, and I think there is a certain communal factor here in the four different items: being with children, visiting and entertaining guests, dancing and going to bars and cafes and nightclubs. They all constitute a measure of sociability. Are the Soviet people more sociable than people in other countries? You know, sometimes it appears to us that in a society with an unpleasantly oppressive government, somehow the people have to draw back and to kind of find comfort and security in interacting among themselves. Again, many people who have traveled in Soviet Russia have been immensely impressed by the friendliness, under proper conditions, of the Soviet people. Are the Soviet people more sociable? No, they're not. Here again, in terms of the best measure available among all these 10 different countries, the hours spent in the company of others is about the same in Soviet Russia as in most other countries. Interestingly, the country of the 10 in which people were most alone, spent the least time in the company of others, was the United States of America. Now, a very important activity that we all know about from time to time is rest. The Soviets, in their writing about the use of free time, sometimes divide rest into two categories: passive rest and active rest. Both kinds are listed here. Walking is active, lying down is passive. I don't know where killing time would go. But in my own observations of Soviet culture, from time to time it has seemed to me that resting is more legitimate in Soviet Russia than it is in the United States. In fact, one might even speculate that there is a widespread informal, what you might call, right to rest in Soviet Russia, which we look upon here with more suspicion. Is there evidence for this? Well, perhaps the time spent in streets and parks is one bit of evidence.
Surprised to find so little time spent being killed.
I use the term killing time as vernacular translation of the Soviet, rather cumbersome phrase, spending time without any obvious goal. Next comes education. According to my estimate, Soviet people, as I mentioned earlier, are studious and are very much in favor of education. Now, education can be carried on not only in formal institutions, but by oneself. And here we have a chance to test out this idea that the Soviet people have been very impressed with Lenin's famous admonition, uchitsa, 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 study, study, study. And sure enough, the comparative data show that in almost every subgroup comparison possible, when people are characterized according to their marital status, their age, their employment, and so on, in almost every subgroup comparison possible, the Russians do indeed seem to spend more time on education than in any other country. An unusual facet of this is the category at the bottom of the page, in the first page of table one, where on the average 7 minutes a day are spent in political study. This means essentially reading Marx, Engels, Lenin, Communist Party literature, and I suppose participating in discussion groups. Now, turning to the next page, we have what I call spectaculars, or attending events as a spectator. And as you can see, a substantial amount of time is spent going to the cinema, athletic events, and so on. And a not inconsiderable amount of time is spent in what I have grouped as active and creative ways, sports, hobbies, outings, tours, and so on. Then we come to an interesting category, political activity. 15 minutes a day spent on politics. And if this figure is calculated not in terms of amount of minutes, but in terms of participation, the author of this study from which the data came reports that, quote, the overwhelming majority of the population are participating regularly in various types of public organizations. This means 78%. Now, the comparative study done in 10 different countries shows that this may not be true, because there was a category of activity, involvement in organizations, and in this particular category, in the comparative study, the Russians ranked very low. How to reconcile these two facts is not yet within my power. You will notice that actually religious behavior is out of order in the table. It should come last. It does indeed come last in terms of the percentage of people who perform religious rites at all, which is 4% according to this study, involving 8/10 of a minute per day. So I think on the basis of this research, we can well ask, has God indeed died in Russia? I come now to the part of my talk which involves a contrast between how people do spend their time and how they would like to. And this distribution of interests and values is found in its original form in column D in the table. And I think that we're probably drawing to the close of our hour together, so I won't go into the details of how I came to the conclusions to which I've come. But if you are interested particularly, they're spelled out in some detail in the notes to the tables, which I will be glad to provide you with if you do not have any in your possession. I do want to call your attention to the fact that the way in which the Soviet people would like to spend their time is not very closely correlated with the way in which they do spend their time. And this gives me the opportunity, which I have been looking for, to contrast the two items. And what I have done is to say, we can define interest in an operational way if we refer to it as the proportion of time devoted to an activity which is greater than the proportion of desire for that activity. If people spend more time doing a certain activity than they really desire to, other things equal, then let's call that an interest. Whereas if they would like to spend more time doing something than they are doing, let's call that a value. What are Soviet interests and values? If my theory and method is correct, we can say the following. And I want to emphasize that I'm not saying here what the Soviet people have to do and what they want to do. I think these are all free time activities and freely chosen. But there is an important difference between them, which I want to comment on. In the first category, interests, people engage in radio listening and reading, activities with their children, in political activity, They visit and they entertain friends, and they lie down to rest. These are the interests of Soviet people in their spare time. But they also have values. What are the values? They would like to attend the theater. They would like to attend musical and literary events, attend exhibits and museums, variety shows, go on tours and outings. They would like to visit bars and cafes more frequently, and they would like to spend more time killing time. They want to play cards, engage in sports and hobbies, and go to the movies more often. Such are interests and values in the Soviet people, as best I can determine them. There is an in-between category, as some of you will notice. These are those activities in which the amount of time people spend seems to be about equivalent to the amount of time they would like to spend. And these I call integrated patterns. And they include television watching, social dancing, education and study. Note that it does not appear as a value in this analysis. Attending athletic events, engaging in amateur art, walking, that accounts for the parks and streets, and playing chess, checkers, dominoes, and so on. I would like to finish now by pointing up some of the distinctions between interests and values in this mode of analysis. Both, I reiterate, are important. Both represent voluntary activities. But they also represent, I think in an efficient way, a supply and demand situation. When the supply of activities is fully adequate, we have an interest involved. When the supply falls short of the demand, we have a value. When they coincide, what do we have? I think what we have is an example of the Confucian ideal of the happy man, a man who has to do what he wants to do and wants to do what he has to do. Another comment on interests, they seem to refer to what you might call reflections or invasions of free time from other systems of activity or other commitments. The most obvious is political activity, and we ought to consider the possibility that political activity in Russia is not really voluntary, but semi-obligatory, and that a wise Soviet citizen will indeed join the trade union, local public and social organizations, go to meetings, sign manifestos, vote in the national elections, and so on. Another interest is radio listening and reading. I think these, always and increasingly important in modern society, show us the extent to which people must keep up with information, with knowledge in modern society to protect their own positions and the positions of their families in economic, political, and social life. Activities with children, here again we have a direct reflection of family roles and obligations. Visiting and entertaining, I think, is an interest in this sense which reflects the desire to maintain a respected place in the informal social network. And finally, last but not least, lying down to rest is an activity which we owe from time to time to our own tired bodies. Now, I've prolonged my discussion to the point where I would like to comment very briefly on the problem of subgroup differences in the use of free time. If you will look at tables 3 to 5, you will find there a series of contrasts for different subgroups in Soviet Russia in respect to the way in which people spend their time and the way in which they would like to spend them, which I think are very provocative and can be very helpful in understanding Soviet social reality. And I'll just give a couple of examples before I conclude. First example, let's take men and women. Men read more than women do. They read the newspapers more frequently and longer, magazines and books. But interestingly enough, if you ask people how they would like to spend their time, women allocate more time to a desire to read than men do. Now, what we have here, I think, is for the group as a whole, a basic important interest. But then when we go through the analytical operation of separating the group as a whole into its components, we find that reading has become more of an interest for men and more of a value for women. What does that mean? Well, I think that what we have here is a minute but important example of a case where one group has more of something that another group wants. And I think this is the prototype of man's life in society. Men read more than women, but women want to read more than men want to read. What does it mean? Well, I think it means possibly stress, misunderstanding, tension, conflict, and possibly social change. More precisely, it depends in this case on the extent to which the facility needed for reading, which is free time, is seen in what political scientists like to call a zero-sum way or a non-zero-sum way. If it's seen in a zero-sum way, as we might well speculate it is among many millions of Soviet husbands and wives, in which there are chores to be done, in which the woman has to do them while the man sits reading the paper, then we might say that this is a cause for antagonism at the very most grassroots level of Soviet society. Throughout these tables, television watching proves to be a remarkably integrated pattern. That is to say, everyone does it in the Soviet Union just about as much as he would like, and there are no significant subgroup differences at all. There are some very provocative age differences to be found, which I will not go into, but in general, the material shows that the young people have more almost of everything, more interests and more values all along the line than do the older people. To conclude, it seems to me that these results are reasonable. Some of them are challenging. I think that they do give us a good start toward the characterization of an entire society. And I hope to continue doing research on this subject in the months ahead. But even more important, I would like to conclude by celebrating enthusiastically the advent to Soviet Russia of genuine social science. I think that what you have heard this morning has been an example of the way in which modern social science reaches down into the people, trying to learn what it is the people need and what it is the people want, and that this is a a healthful and a very optimistic sign on the present world scene. And of course, it should not escape our attention that the Soviet Communist Party is still in complete control and that the Soviet Communist Party does indeed approve this activity. Thank you.
You have been listening to another in a series of lectures given on the campus of Iowa State University in Ames. Today you heard the last in a series of lectures recorded at the 1969 World Affairs Institute on the USSR, the second half century, as H. Kent Geiger, professor of sociology at the University of Wisconsin, lectured on the distribution of values and interests in the Soviet class system. University Lecture is a presentation of Iowa State University Radio.